Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the first meeting of the General Budget Conference Committee. And I do want to thank all of you for joining us for this year's mothership. It's certainly different from the motherships we've had in the past, but the content is certainly no less important. It's been a tough year for all of us, and I'm proud of our work to continue government and leading for our constituents. It's great to be here with my colleague and partner in legislative leadership, Speaker Carl Heastie. And before I go further, I want to recognize Senate Minority Leader Robert Ort and Assembly Minority Leader Will Barclay. Good to see you both as well. The Senate Majority Budget builds on legislation passed already this session to help New Yorkers recover from COVID-19 and support our economic success. The budget delivers emergency aid to help New York recover from the COVID-19 pandemic. The Senate Majority Budget utilizes federal aid to supplement and not supplant state funding. And we're committed to passing a budget that is on time, responsible, and effective. The Senate Majority Leader, and I won't go through all of it, but some highlights: the Senate Majority Budget improves educational opportunities, increases school aid, it implements statewide universal pre-K, it asks the wealthiest New Yorkers and large corporations to do a little more to help in New York's recovery. It delivers tax relief to working and middle-class New Yorkers. It helps local governments. It advances the Clean Water, Green Jobs, Green New York Environmental Bond Act. It authorizes mobile sports betting. It invests in our small businesses. It funds the arts and cultural institution. It helps unemployed workers who did not qualify for unemployment insurance. It restores cuts to Medicaid and public health programs. It supports family farmers. It alleviates barriers in our election system. And it sets us on a path to not only recover, but to build a stronger New York. We have less than 3 weeks to go before our budget is due. And the Senate majority will continue to work diligently in the coming weeks to pass a timely, balanced, and ethical budget. So I want to thank you all. And now I'd like to introduce my colleagues who will be representing the Senate on this committee. First, our finance chair, Senator Liz Krueger. Liz. A deputy majority leader, Mike Gianaris. Revenue committee chair, Brian Benjamin. And alternate member from the majority, chair of the Democratic Conference, Jose Serrano. Again, minority leader, Robert Ort. And as an alternate for the minority, Deputy Minority Leader Andrew Lanza. Thank you. And I now turn it over to, again, my partner, the Assembly Speaker, Carl Heastie.
Thank you, Madam Leader. So good afternoon. On behalf of the Assembly, we're pleased to convene the Joint Budget Conference Committee. At this time, I will introduce the members of the Assembly who are serving on this General Budget Conference Committee. Along with myself, we have Majority Leader Crystal Peoples-Stokes, our Ways and Means Committee Chair Helene Weinstein, Assistant Speaker Phil Ramos, Speaker Pro Tem Jeff Aubrey. We have Minority Leader Will Barclay, who is here in spirit, and I'll get to that in a second. And then we also have Assembly Member Ed Ra. Sadly, Minority Leader Barclay cannot be with us today. I offer my sincerest condolences to him on the passing of his father. He and his family are in our thoughts and prayers. Doug Barclay was the true definition of a public servant. I know it's a tough day. I did speak to Will last night, and he's doing okay. I would like to highlight some of our budget priorities as we move into the next phase of the budget negotiations. There's a substantial level of overlap among the Senate and Assembly budget resolutions, including major investments in education and healthcare and mental hygiene in our human services sector. We provide direct relief to homeowners and tenants who have been devastated by this pandemic, causing instability and uncertainty in communities throughout the state. We both invest in NYCHA and in our statewide public housing infrastructure. We make crucial investments in childcare as our neighbors return to work and in providing resources for those who are excluded from participation in federal relief programs. And by helping those who were left out of other programs, giving them relief will be an immediate boost into our local economies because people will spend resources in their local economies. So that's a very important aspect to think about it, where it just becomes almost a mini stimulus for our local economies. We provide much needed student aid and support for our higher education institutions. We provide communities with tools to address the scourge of gun violence, and we provide for nutrition and food assistance, problems that were exposed for all to see during this pandemic, which were there before the pandemic, but were exacerbated during this pandemic. We each provide necessary aid for small businesses and keeping their doors open, and a lifeline for the arts and cultural institutions whose presence is essential to the resurgence of our state. Our proposals would authorize increased taxes to ensure that no community is left behind. I would be remiss if I didn't offer my deep appreciation to President Joe Biden, U.S. Senate Majority Leader Chuck Schumer, Senator Kirsten Gillibrand, and our entire congressional delegation for the unwavering focus of lifting our state forward and our nation of this crisis. But I do want to point out that the federal funds, they do have a limit, and we want to make long-lasting investments in our future. The federal money helps to make us whole, but there were problems that we had that had a lack of investment before the pandemic. And if we're going to have a true resurgence, we need to make those investments now. As I said, but our federal government has provided a well-rounded set of tools to repair the harms brought on by this virus in every community throughout the state. With your partnership, Madam Leader, I look forward to building upon those efforts. That is just a snapshot of the Assembly Majority's priorities. Look forward to working together to craft a plan that meets the needs of all New Yorkers as we begin to recover and help our families thrive. So I will now turn it back over to you, Madam Leader, for you to call on your counterpart.
Thank you so much, Speaker Heastie. And I too want to offer condolences to Will Barkley and his family during these very difficult times. I'm really sorry to hear that. And, you know, on the brighter note, also, I do want to give a special shout out and gratitude to the Majority Leader, Chuck Schumer, as well as Senator Gillibrand and Nancy Pelosi and our congressional delegation, who really did work so hard to deliver resources that will help us in our recovery. So that being said, I said my longer remarks earlier, so I will now recognize Senator Robert Ort for his remarks.
Thank you very much, Leader. Good to see everyone. I also would like to echo the comments made about Doug Barkley. I spoke to Leader Barkley yesterday, and he's doing okay. His father passed with the family all around him. And I think in light of the pandemic and so many families that didn't get that opportunity, we've come to appreciate probably that more than ever. I just wanted to kind of share that with everybody. I know we have Assemblymember Ra, who I think is filling in for the leader, and I'm sure we'll hear from him after me. I will be brief. This budget, not surprisingly, our conference takes a very different view, certainly on the broad strokes. Yesterday during the debate on the Senate, it was talked about the exodus from New York, the fact that we have led the nation in out-migration for the past 2 years. That was even before the pandemic. I suspect the pandemic has exacerbated and threatens to exacerbate that even further. And the reality is the reason people have left New York State is not coincidentally, but directly related to the policies that have been enacted from the legislature, from the governor, over a long time. And this budget does nothing to change that trend. In fact, it doubles down on many of the reasons why people have left. We're increasing taxes by $6.3 billion on businesses of all sizes. Our spending growth is going up 15.3% year over year. At a time when so many businesses and so many folks are having to do with less, we're increasing spending by over 15% after many years holding around 2%. We remove safeguards within the state's unemployment insurance program. And we continue to ignore the parity between the MTA investments and the rest of Long Island and New York State when it comes to capital and infrastructure and transportation monies. Those are just a few of the key points where I feel this budget not only falls short, but goes in the wrong direction. But again, in short, our conference's position is this budget will only continue the exodus from New York State. Now, maybe there's those who are wealthy enough to stay, and there's those who are leaving, but there's also those who are unable to leave, even though they would like to. They are unable to leave because their kids are in school. They're unable to leave because they lack the means to go. And so whether you're a business owner trying to create jobs, whether you're a working mother or working parent who is stuck here in New York State, but increasingly find it unaffordable, our conference will continue to fight and advocate on behalf of those New Yorkers who continue to search for a more affordable and better Empire State. Leader, thank you.
I now recognize Assembly Ways and Means Ranking Member Ed Robb for opening comments on behalf of Assembly Minority Leader Barkley, who cannot be here today, as I mentioned earlier, to the death of his beloved father. Mr. Robb.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And on behalf of Leader Barkley, thank you to you and Leader Stewart-Cousins and Leader Ort for your kind words and condolences on the loss of Ambassador Doug Barkley. You said truly a public servant in every sense of the word, served in the state Senate for many years and served the country in various capacities as well. So thank you. You know, similar to what Leader Ort was saying, you know, we view the One House budgets, obviously, in a different lens. They are somewhat of a political statement rather than policy document. But we do think that New Yorkers should be nervous about what they saw in these two documents. You know, it certainly does reflect a fundamental difference in ideology and the role of government. And when we look at this budget and the fact that our current state tax receipts have rebounded, the federal stimulus monies that, you know, we're thankful are coming from Washington do address the immediate financial hardship that we thought we were going to be in. And put us on a good foot forward with this budget. And I think that going forward with the policies that are proposed and the increases in taxes are doubling down on a misguided approach that had put us into a $7 billion hole long before we had ever heard of COVID. I think it will continue to put us at an economic disadvantage. And especially as we're looking and seeing the increase in flexibility, people working from home, people leaving our state during the COVID crisis, they're no longer tethered to their New York offices, and they're more capable of relocating than ever. Just want to put forth for some context, Texas has a population of 29 million people, annual budget of $112 billion. Florida has a population of 21.5 million and an annual budget of 97 million. New York's population of 19.4 million is smaller than each of those states, but the majority's proposed a budget that is nearly equal to Florida's and Texas combined. Once again, our population continues to drop while our spending continues to rise. I do want to point out there are certainly some good elements to these proposals and you know, the restorations of some of the cuts proposed by the governor. I note things like library funding, AIM funding, and certainly the veteran services that we all certainly know are necessary. But we want to make sure that in our adopted budget, we encourage individuals and businesses to stay in New York. And we need to do our best to show that New York is a place to start and grow a business and help our economy rebound from this pandemic. The last thing I will note, as has often been noted by our conference in the past, we believe an on-time budget can be done in an open and transparent manner and can be done so with legislative input from all of the conferences, including the two minorities. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Ra. I would like to announce that the Senate and Assembly have each executed the joint certificate, beginning the conference committee process in an effort to reconcile variations in the budget proposals passed by each House.
The recording secretary for the Senate will be Shelley Andrews.
The Assembly designates Kevin Frick as the Assembly's recording secretary of the General Conference Committee. Each leader has named members to the various joint budget subcommittees, and the names will be announced through press release from each House.
The General Conference Committee will meet as needed. The Joint Budget Subcommittee's meetings will follow the General Conference Committee meeting in accordance with the announced schedule.
This meeting of the General Conference Committee is adjourned, subject to the call of the co-chairs. Thank you, everyone. Please stay safe.
Thank you. Bye.